be wrong. This valley of death. Listen, please listen. Don't want to have too many conversations. That is nothing.
Here we are at the end of the year, and of course I got my list here, my top favorite list. Of course, this is only my favorites of the year. This is not my best albums of the year list. If it was my best, I think it would be drastically different, but it's just my most favorite. Now, of course, before we hop into it, I did do a video of this halfway through the year, going over my favorites of the year. Halfway through the year, or around halfway through the year. Stuff has changed since then. Some albums have grown on me more, some maybe dropped down a bit on my list, and maybe some new ones appeared on the list. But like I kind of covered in that video, this year has just been so crazy for music, so absolutely stacked. Has to be one of the best years for music, and one of the reasons that is of course the pandemic. Everyone's just been able to focus really on their craft and produce some amazing pieces of art throughout this year. And I found a lot of the darker projects of the year really started to grab out and take a huge new form and just embody this whole feeling of the past 2 years. And yeah, there's a couple of those projects that really dive into that and really encapsulate what is the feeling and energy of these past few years. Now, of course, with it being such a overly stacked year, of course, there's going to be some that aren't on my favorites list, but it's not like I haven't listened to them. They just didn't land on my favorites list. Of course, once again, this is not my best albums of the year list. This is just my favorite. I don't think I will do a best albums of the year list because it does come down to taste at the end of the day. So, like last time, I'm going to go through my least favorite out of the most favorite albums in the year. And of course, near the top or near the end of the video, it is going to cover the absolute most favorite out of my most favorites of the year. So nothing on here is not my favorite. It's just that it's lower on the list because it's competing with just so much other more favorites. Now, some albums I should just give a mention here that didn't make it onto the list but was close. I'll just rapid fire throw out some names here. So of course we got Jubilee, Japanese Breakfast, of course, and the West Side Gun double album that released this year. Pretty great as well. Stand For Myself, also a pretty empowering record. Of course, I gotta mention A Beginner's Mind, fantastic one there. Just missed the list. And then Daddy's Home as well, a very great one as well. Just not my most favorite of the year. Pray for Haiti, also a very great one. Ska Dream and Sound Ancestors, really great as well. The new King Gizzard album, the new Idols album. I mean, there's a lot, so I'm probably just gonna stop here before I just keep mentioning albums for the next 20 minutes. But let's hop into the list, finally. Now, the ones at the bottom here, I'm gonna speed through a bit. Then as we go on, I'm gonna go into more detail with each project. But of course, the one at the bottom, the bottom most favorite album of the year, for me, is of course Porter Robinson's Nurture. This is a pretty good electropop slash like glitch pop, or I guess house or synth pop. I mean, there's a lot going on here. It is very uplifting, very peaceful, and just a nice thing to listen to. It's kind of hypnotizing, so yeah, it's just something to put on. I mean, there isn't too many tracks that crazy stand out for me here. That's why it's at the bottom of my most favorites. But one that did stand out and stick with me, and of course is my most favorite track off the album, is Musician. Here's a quick sample before we move on into the next album. Next up, we got, of course, the self-titled album from Shelly, and this is a very luscious one here. Of course, this is his comeback album, and it was a pretty good one, and it did land on my favorites midway through the year, or near midway through the year, It is a very luscious, grand, and almost laid back too, and very soul heavy, neo soul, passionate, and very luscious. And my favorite tracks off this album, of course, the first track, All Pride Aside, Exposure, also a pretty nice track, Beautiful, one of my absolute favorites, and Cooking with Grease and Remedies to end off the favorites off the album. But yeah, let's hop into a sample and we'll move on into the next. Beautiful the stars when they lit by the moon. I said, beautiful the lady, it's you. Beautiful as baby when it's fresh from the womb. I said, beautiful the lady, it's you. Next up, we got, of course, Benny the Butcher's The Plugs I Met 2. This is obviously the second part of The Plugs I Met, another project that Benny the Butcher released earlier. And I think I do like the first one a bit better than the second one, but that doesn't mean the second one isn't good as well. Of course, it brings that East Coast hip-hop vibe and lots of great bars and great flows. And the latter half of the project, of course, is my favorite, with the last couple tracks really getting a strong wrap-up to the overall project. My favorite tracks here is When Tony Met Sosa, Overall, Live By It, and pretty much the whole second half of the project. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. The beat is clean, I had to live through filth. Your dog'll get you pilt. For you to stand as tall, I gotta get you stilts. You got plans on getting rich, well consider this. The ones who expect the most favors ain't give you shit. I was the best cook, stepped on work with my right and left. Next up, of course, we got more Griselda out here, and this is, of course, Conway the Machine's If It Bleeds, It Can Be Killed. Once again, another East Coast hip-hop album. We got, of course, Conway delivering those ruthless bars, and on the production, we got Big Ghost. And I do honestly enjoy the production on this album a lot more than The Plugs That I Met too. I mean, that's why it's above it on my favorites. I don't really have any least favorite tracks here. I like them all pretty equally, but I guess to point out some favorites off of this, I mean, it's only 10 tracks long at 30 minutes. Jay Batters, Kill All Rats, Toast, Losses to Blessings, and Red Beams, probably the most enjoyable. But yeah, let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Seven, I'm sick. They caught us leaving Shay's funeral fresh as a bitch. They told me, bro, I promise you, I ain't stressing, don't trip. Just keep applying pressure, show them you a legend, that's it. That's why I'll never leave. Next up, we got a pretty exciting one here. The crossover between Converge and Chelsea Wolf, of course, it is Blood Moon 1. Now, I guess I could say this is a pretty hyped up album, and I guess a lot of people were waiting for this album. Me included, I was excited to see what this could be, and I was not disappointed. Of course, it made it into my favorites of the year. Now, how do I describe this album? It is a gothic metal album, or a sludge metal album. Very new genre for me, haven't really dived into too much. I guess a better name for it could be atmospheric metal, but sludge metal, gothic metal, whatever the genre is, it is pretty good. Of course, it's very dense and it is progressive, and the vocals here by Chelsea Wolf really adds a very nice element and depth to the entire album. My favorite tracks here is Blood Moon, Viscera of Men, Coil, Crimson Stone, and Blood Dawn. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Next up here, we got Turnstile's album, Glow On. Now, this is a alt rock slash hardcore project, and there is a lot of really great energetic tracks in this one. It's short, dense, packed with heat, banger tracks after banger tracks. Some of my absolute favorite tracks on this one is Mystery, Don't Play, Holiday, Endless, Alien Love Call, and of course, New Heart Design and TLC. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Next up, we got even more Griselda here, and it is Conway the Machine's La Machina. Now, of course, this is East Coast hip hop. There's nothing really special about this album that really stands out. It is pretty much the same style, same killer flows, killer bars, good storytelling as well. And the thing that really puts this above the previous Conway the Machine record, it is very greatly produced. I mean, you got Alchemist here on one or two of the tracks. My favorite tracks off this album is, of course, 630, Tip Off, Blood Roses, 200 Pies, Grace, and SE Gang to finish it off, with the West Side Gun and Benny the Butcher, Griselda finishing off and wrapping up the record. Let's play a quick sample and we'll move on into the next album. 100 racks in my sweatpants, did my scoring in Portland. I'm Bonzi Wells with the headband. Build the next powerhouse record label, that was my next plan. Drum work like Death Row in the 90s mixed with Def Jam. We the Death Squad, but I shoot solo on Ratman. Right hand holding the steering wheel, busting back with my left hand. Speaking of Alchemist, I'm gonna cheat here and put two albums in this spot. And of course, that is Alchemist's little project that he did, two of the little projects that he did. Of course, I'm talking about This Thing of Ours 1 and 2. Now, I do like the first one much, much better because, of course, Earl Sweatshirt's presence on the first album or project is a lot more surprising and a lot more fun and fresh. And Earl is just great, and you got Boldy James there as well. But once again, it's really because of Earl. He just comes in with a new, fresh energy on this first project, and it's really hypnotizing. It's just great to see Earl back in this space. And on the second one, of course, we got the fun features from Bruiser Brigade and, of course, Vince Staples. That track is a very nice one with Vince. The track with the Loopers was also pretty nice, but very short. But yeah, my favorite tracks off the first This Thing of Ours is all of them. I do like and enjoy all of them pretty greatly, and there only is 4 or 8 if you count the instrumentals. And on the second part to this album or project, we got my favorite tracks being Flying Spirit and 6-5 Heartbeats. Let's play a sample or two and we'll move on into the next album. Depths of the man that I was from the start, stay next to the fam. Got a place in my heart, chest, breath on demand. The rest of the plan got scrapped when I landed, invested in arcs. I do less when I stretch before I hit the bar. Pull up, tan crest on the shoulder of the coat of arms. Told you we the best till we good and gone. Yeah, love shit. Next up, we got a pretty exciting hip hop record here, and it is, of course, Skyzoo's All the Brilliant Things. Now, Skyzoo, very underrated artist here, and he's bringing probably what might be his best album yet, All the Brilliant Things. Full of references and great concepts and great production as well. Just an overall good album, and my favorite tracks off this one is Free Jewelry, St. James Liquors, Humble Brag, Plugs and Connections, Bed-Stuy is Burning, and What Money Taught Us. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Henny on the back of my breath, I ain't buy it though. Tucked it in the back of the steps, you know how Scala go. Fast forward, I still pour it all through the barrio. Word to all the condos coming to tell us vominos. Backseat of my Jeep, swing an episode. Next up, we got the very exciting, what could be considered as the pop album of the year by many, even though there is lots of competition this year. It is, of course, Magdalena Bay's Mercurial World. Now, of course, this is a synth-pop slash electro-pop album, and it has a very intriguing or interesting concept. What the duo brings here is not only something completely fresh, but very great run of tracks, some very banger ones as well. The production is amazing, and it is very catchy. My favorite tracks here is the title track, Secrets, Your Fire, You Lose, Cherry, Hysterical Us, Domino, and Dream Catching. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Next up, we got the highly anticipated collaboration between Anderson .Paak and, of course, Bruno Mars on An Evening with Silk Sonic, and Silk Sonic, of course, being the name of the duo. Very soul-heavy, bringing back that 70s vibe, of course, filled with a lot of soul and funk. Favorite tracks here are Leave the Door Open, After Last Night, Smoking Out the Window, Put on a Smile, and Skate. Let's play a sample, and we'll move on into the next album. Next up, we got the one and only Kanye West, Donda. Now, a year or two ago, this album used to be a myth, and people used to think this was the next Yandhi. Then, of course, Ye decided to tweet out the album cover and, of course, announced Donda that is coming soon. And he gave us a month or a date, and by no surprise, we didn't get it, and it became a myth, and it got leaked as well. Some of the tracks off the original Donda got leaked. And of course, there were some tracks on there that were on Yandhi and that album that never released. But after a year and a whole lot of chaos, we finally got the official release of Donda, and with the new album cover, the blacked out album cover. I mean, you just cut out a few tracks away and this is a contender for one of his best albums yet. And that's pretty amazing to think about. My favorite tracks here is Jail, God Breathe, Hurricane, Off the Grid, Life of the Party, Moon, Come to Life, Believe What I Say, No Child Left Behind, 24. I mean, it just goes on. Let's just play a sample and we'll move on into the next album because there's just way too much here.
It's the life of the party. To think I could have almost died. Lord, help us.
Hey, Miss Donda, you're running to my mama. Please tell her I said say something. I'm starting to believe ain't no such thing as heaven's trumpets. No after over, this is it done. If there's a heaven, you would think they let you speak to your son. Maybe she has in the form of a baby's laugh I heard passing by in a stroller, reminding me, hey, keep rolling. Oh no, maybe she has with the prick of a blade of grass I've been laying on way too long.
Next up, we got something that was pretty high up on my previous list at the halfway point of the year, but it dropped down a bit because, of course, I've grown to these albums. I've listened to all of these albums on this list multiple times, diving into them and really picking apart what it is and how I feel about them. And the album I'm talking about is, of course, the debut album from Squid, Bright Green Field. Now, just because it dropped down this far doesn't mean it's bad or anything. It's just that I've grown to like a lot more of the albums more than this one. Of course, this is a post-punk album, a very exciting genre to be listening to in 2021. And I guess you can say this is art punk as well, because the progression in these tracks and just the overall concepts and just the instrumentation, the production, it is just all really great. Like, Narrator is still, at the end of the year, one of my songs of the year. It's chaotic, it's energetic, progressive, and complex. But I do feel the formula is repeated a lot throughout all of these tracks, and that's why it really went down on my list, because I've grown to notice it. But yeah, still a great album, of course. It is good enough to land on my favorites of the year list, so yeah, it's still great. My favorite tracks here is, of course, Narrator. Stunning, absolutely stunning track there. Paddling, also a very great one. Documentary Filmmaker, 2010. Global Groove and Pamphlets to finish it off. A strong finish on the final track there. Yeah, let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Next up, we got Slow Ties Tyron. This is a UK hip-hop slash trap album, and it is Slow Ties' second studio album, and it's very exciting because it has two sides to it. Of course, it is the first dark, aggressive, energetic side, and the more melodic, toned down, and relaxing side on the second half of the album. And I do quite like the production and everything about the second half of the album a lot more. It reminds me of Flower Boy. But yeah, my favorite tracks here is 45 Smoke, Cancelled, Maza, Vex, I tried focus, terms, push, NHS, and feel away pretty much the whole half, the whole second half of the album. But yeah, let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. The bubble gotta line it up when push comes to shove. You gotta push. System lagging, think we need a reboot. Feeling stranded, got me feeling feeble. You're never there when I really need you. Always land on my feet like a cat out of tree. When she crumbled to sound when I'm gritting my teeth. Shit flies with the magpies. He drowned, got baptized. Oh well, I guess that's life. So now I got a pastime. So quiet, hear a penny drop right in my head, and it's loud as fuck. Next up, we got the exciting return collaboration with The Alchemist and Boldy James, of course, bringing Bo Jackson. Now, their previous full collaboration album, The Price of Tea in China, was one of my favorite albums of 2020, and everyone was hyped for another collaboration with Boldy James and Alchemist coming back again, and of course, they announced Bo Jackson, and here we are. I mean, Alchemist needs no introduction, legendary producer. And the beats on here is just immaculate, crazy, insane, dark, dense, and Boldy James once again bringing his rough flows and clever wordplays. It's just great. My favorite tracks on here is Double Hockey Sticks, Steel Wool, Photographic Memories, Diamond Dollars, Flight Risk, Illegal Search and Seizure, Fake Flowers, and Verse 48 Freestyle and Drug Zone to finish it off. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album.
Down to my last 48 hours. Hit me up that features career, buddy. Nigga won't smoke, I put that pain in. Judge tried to hang him, couldn't show up to the arraignment. Hot boy, it's 227, if it ain't that, fuck as you claim. Creatures. Niggas ain't gang, when they reach for that, I leave them hanging. No, I re-rock, piece of cake, I beat the case, right back on that gang. Should I catch a op, hand me the Drake.
Next up, we got Nas making quite a comeback here with, of course, King's Disease 2. Now, King's Disease 1 wasn't something too crazy, but there was a breath of fresh air from Nas, and it was the album that started this comeback from Nas. King's Disease 2 also has Hit-Boy on the production throughout, and it is amazing. So this man Nas and Hit-Boy decided to drop a special album out of nowhere, and on this album Nas truly proves that yes, he is back in rare form, and I do quite like this album a lot better than King's Disease 2. One of his best albums in years, and if it was actually in my top favorites list, then it would be pretty high up, but I'm just gonna stick it in here with King's Disease 2. Since, of course, this came out so late in the year, I wasn't able to dive into it too much. But yeah, back to the video. Nas taking on a rare form in this album, as he quotes himself, and of course, bringing back that insane, classic, yet up-to-date production, and Hit-Boy is just insane. Kanye brought the Lauryn Hill sample on Donda, but Nas just straight up got Lauryn Hill featured on a track, and that is of course one of my favorite tracks of the year. Elite storytelling, elite production, just overall great, great hip-hop album this one is, and my favorite tracks of this one, The Pressure, Death Row East, Rare, and these next run of tracks is amazing. Store Run, Moments, Nobody, of course the one with Lauryn Hill, No Phony Love with Charlie Wilson, fantastic one there too. Count Me In, Composure, My Bible, and Nas is good to finish it off. Yeah, just great album this one is, and very excited for King's Disease 3. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album.
I turned the other cheek, I took blow after blow. There's so much crisis in the world cause you reap what you sow. When you keep what you know is meant for someone else. Did you dig for them, you might just end up in yourself. I'm in the secret place, I keep a sacred space. They keep showing their hands, but keep hiding their face. If I'm a messenger, you block me, then you block the message. So aggressive, the world you made is what you're left with.
Next up, we got one of my favorite albums in this genre, and it is, of course, Bad Bad Not Good's Talk Memory. Now, if 2021 wasn't stacked enough, we got Bad Bad Not Good making a comeback album here, and it is, of course, a jazz fusion album, or chamber jazz, spiritual jazz, whatever you want to call it. Either way, it is the long-awaited next project from Bad Bad Not Good. The amazing and beautiful instrumentation in this album and the amazing features and the classic jazz throwbacks on this album is just amazing. The combination of the synths, the bass, guitar, the sax, and the keys is just all amazingly tied together and combined to make this beautiful wall of sound. My favorite tracks here is every single track. I have no least favorite track. I love them all quite a bit. But the one I love the most out of all of them has to be Beside April and Signal from the Noise. Just fantastic album, fantastic run of tracks. Highly, highly recommend this one. But yeah, let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Next up, we got another surprising one here, and it is Arca's Kick 5. And this is, of course, not the only Kick project in the list, as a little spoiler. But Kick 5 has to be one of my most favorite projects out of the Kick series, of course, behind one other one. But Kick 5 is an ambient slash classical or post-minimalism album. I guess modern classical would be a better way to put it. It's also artistic, of course, and very abstract as well. It goes for the whole Kick series, the compositions, the arrangements, and the whole dark aura. This dark, thick aura this album creates is really something to just get lost into. It's just full out artistry at display, and the album cover, of course, displays what this album really sounds like as well, and what it'll feel like. It's melancholic, it's ethereal, it's just really great, and it is one to look out for 2021. But yeah, my favorite tracks on here is Poo, P-U, and sorry if I pronounce these wrong because I don't speak Spanish. We have Chiquito, Estrogen, Ether, Sanctuary, Muscolo, if that's how you say it, La Infinita, and of course Fire Prayer and Crown. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Next up, we got the legendary Godspeed You, Black Emperor, this amazing band coming back to drop a very great project in their legendary discog, and this one is quite good compared to the rest, and I do think this is one of their best in a while, and it is of course God's Pee at State's End. Now, with their two most recent projects in the late 2010s, it seemed like they were going on a downtrend, but they proved us all wrong here with this 2021 project. Of course, it is a post-rock album. Of course, like always, there's a sense of anarchy in their music, and it is very dark, and there's lots of atmosphere, and the sound they create here goes back to their early works in the 2000s, and it really captures that sound, and it seems like they are trying to build upon it, but at some points it does sound like a very similar style with just nothing added onto it, and that's not a bad thing at all. I mean, those tracks are still fantastic. I mean, it doesn't compare at all to the older projects because those ones are masterpieces, but this one in 2021, it is still great and one of my favorites for sure. My favorite tracks here is Job's Lament, First of the Last Glaciers, Fire at Static Valley, Government Came, Cliff's Gaze, and Our Side Has to Win. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. This next one caught me really by surprise, and it is something really amazing that I'm glad I came across. And it is Paranoles, if that's how you say it, To See the Next Part of the Dream. Now, this is a Korean shoegaze album, or a post-rock album as well. And for me, I'd say it has to be one of the best concept albums of the year. The huge, crushing atmosphere this album creates, paired with the really depressing concepts and all of these crazy, raw, and passionate performances, It's so chaotic, yet there's some beautiful melodies that you can latch onto in every single track. While some people might not like the vocals on this album, I don't really find them too crazy as well, but I think it's done on purpose to create this raw atmosphere, and it's just crushing, just absolutely crushing and demolishing. I guess you could go to noise rock as an example for this, but of course there is a huge element of shoegaze and influenced by post-rock as well. One of my favorites of the year overall, and I do say it is one of the best concept albums of the year. Highly, highly recommend giving it a listen. You're either gonna leave this album super depressed or just extremely crushed, or even both. But yeah, my favorite tracks on this is Beautiful World, Analog Sentimentalism, White Ceiling, phenomenal track, of course the title track, Age of Fluctuation, definitely my absolute favorite off the album. Then of course the final track, I Can Feel My Heart Touching You. Yeah, let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Post-punk was very exciting for 2021 with Bright Green Field and this album right here. And also, I guess another album I will mention later on in the list. I guess you could fit it into that post-punk era we're in right now. Well, the album I'm talking about here is, of course, the debut album from Black Country, New Road, for the first time. Now, just like Squid, this is another UK rock band that debuted their album. It's an experimental slash post-rock slash post-punk album. And this one is real special because it is very manic, I guess the word to describe it. It's very suspenseful and, of course, very progressive, like Squid's project as well. But I would say BCNR does push the boundaries here, and they go for a way more experimental sound and more of an abstract art rock sound than a progressive experimental rock sound like on Bright Green Field. Even though there is lots of amazing progressions in this album as well, but the main thing here is the performances as well. Like on Bright Green Field, the performances here are also very passionate. And of course, it's very poetic and cryptic as well. It's just an overall amazing, crazy, chaotic album. One of the best, if not the best, post-punk album this year. And of course, this year brought a lot of great post-punk projects and experimental rock projects from the UK as well. It's a lot of good albums from the UK this year, and this is definitely one of them and one of the best. But yeah, my favorite tracks on this thing is, of course, Athens, France, Science Fair, Sunglasses, Track X, and Opus. Basically, the whole album minus the starting track. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Next up, we have another surprising one. 2021 was full of surprises, and this is, of course, one of them. And it is none other than the legendary Lowe's Hey What. Now, this album is extremely heavy. It is very dense, and there is just so much noise and this huge crushing wall of sound that just envelops you and just explodes your mind. Now, as for the genre of this album, it's very industrial. I guess you could say it's post-industrial and experimental rock as well. The album is also very ambient. It's also, of course, abstract. It's hypnotic as well, and there's a very dark side, but also an ethereal side. Like mentioned before, it's very noisy, very noise heavy. I mean, this is definitely one of the loudest albums I've listened to this year, so be careful if you do listen to this album. Make sure your volume is not too high because your ears will explode. Now, there is some religious themes thrown out here and there, and this crushing wall of sound just complements all of the concepts this album goes for. It's like a cold crush of hope, like a disappearing horizon. It's beautiful, yet somewhat terrifying. It's just a lot. It is a lot, and it is definitely one of my favorites of this year by far. The transitions between these tracks are also phenomenal, and I would say this has to be one of, if not the best produced album of the year. So yeah, it's just very crazy, insane, chaotic, crushing. It is just amazing. Highly recommend listening to it, and be careful with your volume when you are listening to this album once again. But onto my favorite tracks. My favorite tracks here is White Horses, I Can Wait, All Night, Disappearing, Hey, Days Like These, which is a phenomenal track, one of the songs of the year in my opinion, and of course more to finish it off. But yeah, let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album, and beware of the volume here because of course it's gonna be pretty loud. Phenomenal album that one is, but speaking of phenomenal albums, of course, a very hype one here, and we were all waiting for this. Of course, it's been a while since we've seen this band back in this raw energy, and of course, I'm talking about Brockhampton's Roadrunner. Now, during 2020, of course, we got Technical Difficulties, a very interesting project that they did during 2020 live, and it was pretty insane, but we were expecting an album, and the album they gave us here is really something special. Even though some tracks are off Technical Difficulties, and some older tracks are on here as well, but we got something really, really special here, and it is a contender for one of the best Brockhampton albums ever. And of course, that's not an easy thing with the legendary Saturation series, but Roadrunner really brings that raw energy from the Saturation series back, but everyone is more matured. The flows are matured, the concepts are matured, the production is insane, and this is definitely Joba's album. A lot of the concepts, main concepts of the album focus on Joba, but some tracks are that classic hip-hop slash pop rap sound, but some are also very experimental as well, and it goes very deep into Joba's personal life, and it's also a very conscious album overall with tracks like Don't Shoot Up the Party and Kevin Abstract's verses on The Light and The Light Part 2. It's just a perfectly crafted jewel they've made here, and it is definitely one of my favorites. Definitely one of the best hip-hop albums of the year. And the features on this album, I didn't even get to talk about the features. They are insane. Danny Brown's feature has to be one of the best features of the year out of any track anywhere. And of course, you've got JPEG Mafia on there as well. You got ASAP Rocky, ASAP Ferg. You got Charlie Wilson. It's just insane. Their next album is supposedly their last as Brockhampton. We'll see what they bring us, but Roadrunner is definitely one for the books. My favorite tracks on here is Buzzcut, of course, one of the songs of the year in my opinion. Danny Brown absolutely kills it on that track. Of course, Chain On with JPEG Mafia, Bankroll with ASAP Rocky and ASAP Ferg, The Light, another phenomenal track, one of my favorites, absolute favorites off the album. Windows, a Brockhampton cypher type track. I'll Take You On with Charlie Wilson. What's the Occasion, very Beatles-esque. And of course, When I Ball, Don't Shoot Up the Party, one of the best Brockhampton songs in a while as well. and finishing it off at The Light Part 2. Crushing. Let's play a sample and I'll move on into the next album.
Our secret shadow people and needles fading through a peephole. Bedtime stories from purgatory. I miss you. For the record, I can fly around the world, absorbing light. Something's missing deep inside. Something changed in Texas. I missed my exit.
Next up, we got an album from one of my favorite artists ever and one of the very exciting growing artists in the last decade, and it is none other than Tyler, the Creator's Call Me If You Get Lost. Now, these two spots I feel like I could switch between any time, between Roadrunner and Call Me If You Get Lost, but Call Me If You Get Lost is Tyler's comeback record to his rap. It's hardcore hip hop with amazing samples and beautiful production. The expectations were really high coming off Igor, one of the best albums of the decade and one of my favorite albums of all time. Call Me If You Get Lost, while it is not better than Igor, it does accomplish something Igor couldn't accomplish, and that is just the absolutely crazy sample usage and amazing flows, and it's hardcore hip-hop at its finest, while Igor was more a conceptual and artistic album, even though Call Me If You Get Lost does have a very artistic side to it as well on tracks like Sweet / I Thought You Wanted to Dance. Call Me If You Get Lost is like a combination of Wolf and Cherry Bomb, and it's like the modern updated Wolf we've all been wishing for. This is definitely the victory lap album after Igor, and it is phenomenal, definitely one to listen to, and a very fantastic one from Tyler, the Creator here, continuing his streak on his crazy three-peat with Flower Boy, Igor, and now Call Me If You Get Lost. Watching Tyler grow throughout the whole decade has been fascinating, and I'm excited to see what is next. My favorite tracks on here is Corso, What's Your Name, Lumberjack, Hot Wind Blows, Massa, Run It Up, Manifesto, Sweet / I Thought You Wanted to Dance, Rise, Juggernaut, and Safari. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album.
Purchase more wheels when I feel like I'm third wheeling. My favorite part of the double R's, the bird ceiling. The panoramic view of the sky and the sun beaming. That ray of light show that nobody is front seating. I'm on the hunt for perfect, but decent is what I've been on. I know she fell in love, but commitment is not my end goal.
Next up, we got another fantastic one here. I mean, everything going forward is just so competitive, it is truly hard to put them in order for a list. But next up, of course, we got a debut album from Genesis Owusu, and it is, of course, Smiling With No Teeth. Now, this is an experimental hip-hop / neo-soul album. It is a very dark conceptual album, but some of the instrumentals and some small themes are very uplifting as well at some points. But sometimes that is a trick and it is just dark depressive, like on songs like A Song About Fishing. It has a very happy-go-lucky instrumental and very sunshine-like, but the content and concept of it is very dark and depressing. Some of the tracks here also get very passionate and aggressive, of course going with that black dog concept that is woven into the entire album. The production is great, the lyrics is great, the concept is great, the performance is great, everything is just great, and it is definitely one of my favorites of the year, close to the top 10 favorites in my list. Highly, highly recommend this one, and give it a few listens because it is very dense. There's lots of content to explore. Of course, the concepts is very great, and the album is just intricately crafted. And as a debut album, this being this good, it is just very amazing to think what is coming next for Genesis Owusu. Definitely an artist to keep an eye on, because this is a crazy debut album to have. Heavy neo-soul vibe, conscious hip-hop, even some post-punk in there as well. R&B, experimental hip hop. It's just a lot. Very, very great album. My favorite tracks here is The Other Black Dog, Centerfold, Waiting on You, Don't Need You, Drown, Gold Chains, Smiling with No Teeth, of course the title track, Black Dogs, Whipcracker, Easy, A Song About Fishing, No Looking Back, and Bye Bye. Phenomenal album, highly recommend listening. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album.
Feels like M&M's and I'm hoping they don't relapse. On stage the crowd yelling, don't get lost in feedback. My boo said I should take it slow, wish I could heed that without the burning of a fucking greenback. So cold.
And here we are in my top 10 favorites of the year, 2021, crazy, crazy year. And this album was actually a bit low on my first list on halfway through the year. But of course, I've grown to like this album a lot more. And of course, I'm talking about Spelling's The Turning Wheel. Now, I've seen this album floating around Rate Your Music for a good couple months, and one day I decided to listen to it, and of course, I noticed right away the production on this album is absolutely phenomenal, so automatically I was drawn in. But when the vocals came in and everything else came in, it had this fantasy pop feel, and it was something I wasn't too much enjoying that much at the time. And this is my introduction album to this artist, so I wasn't expecting anything, but it did surprise me very greatly. And fast forward to now, this album still, once again, it has to be one of the best produced albums of the year, next to Lowe's Hey What. But the absolutely phenomenal production aside, the vocals here is absolutely amazing. I've grown to like them a lot more. Of course, the vocal range Spelling displays on this album is quite fascinating, and it is extremely hypnotizing. And when you pair that with the concept of the album, of course, it is split in two. There is the light half of the album, then the second darker half of the album, which I do quite enjoy a bit more. You get put in this crazy, fantastical, mystical, mysterious world Spelling creates with their vocals and the absolutely immensely great production on this one. It is just a perfectly crafted album inside out. There is nothing you can really look for that isn't just absolutely fantastic production wise. Of course, it is an art pop album. It is very experimental at some points. Of course, it brings in a lot of guitars, a lot of other instrumentation, and just grand production. I would have to say this is definitely contender for pop album of the year, if not the album of the year in general. The menacing vocal range and the twisted, mystical feel of this album, the atmosphere, everything is just on 10, and it is absolutely smashed, perfect hit. I've always been a huge fan of the production on this album, but the thing that made me put this album up so high is the vocals and the vocal performance, and that has grown on me a lot, and it is definitely a must-listen album. So with me growing into the vocals and this whole mystical fantasy art pop feel of the whole album, paired with the just phenomenal, phenomenal, phenomenal production, of course, this had to be in my top 10 most favorites of the year. Stunningly beautiful instrumental passages, stunningly beautiful vocals as well, and as sometimes very dark and dense and twisted as well. A very grand art pop album that everyone should listen to in 2021. My favorite tracks here is Little Deer, Turning Wheel, Awaken, Emperor with an Egg, Boys at School, one of the songs of the year, Legacy, Queen of Wands, Magic Act, and my absolute favorite on the album, Revolution, to finish it off. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album.
Thank you.
Next up, we got another album of the year contender, and it is none other than Simbi's, aka Sometimes I Might Be Introvert, by of course Little Sims, aka Simbi. Clever title there, and the cleverness does not end there. This album is filled with clever wordplays, amazing flows, and grand, fantastic production. It is just stunningly beautiful, and even the interludes, every single interlude on this album is so well produced, so grand. The whole flow of the album is flawless. The production once again is flawless. The concepts is crazy, very conscious, and a very dense album to intake and take apart if you do want to dive into the lyrics very well, because of course there's a lot of content here, and it is one of the reasons it is a contender for the album of the year. Like, what more can you ask for? A grand hip-hop album with crazy conceptual tracks one after another, tied together with some of the best interludes I've heard ever. This album is like a Kanye meeting Kendrick, and those two minds clash together into this one project, just making this very grand, beautifully crafted and meticulously crafted jewel. This album is definitely a must listen, and I think it is one of Simbi's best, if not the best album from Little Sims. Just another great album from the UK. I mean, this is what, the second great album or favorite UK hip-hop album on my list. This introspective piece of art is really one to listen to, and if you don't really want to dive in it, I can describe it a little bit here. It is, of course, conscious hip-hop and neo-soul, jazz, and that grand orchestral production in there as well. And of course, it is poetic, extremely poetic and triumphant. It is progressive and optimistic, political too. It is just everything tied together into this one grand project. There's just an immense amount of effort at display in every single track. There is one or two tracks that I don't quite like, and that is the one or two tracks holding me from giving this album a 10. But everything else is just filled with passion and power. It is just a lightning in a bottle moment. One of the best conceptual albums of the year and albums of the year in general. A must listen. My favorite tracks off this one is Introvert, of course, one of the songs of the year. One of the best songs I've heard in a long, long, long time. Woman, Two Worlds Apart, I Love You, I Hate You. Little Q Part 2, Gems, of course, the interludes on this album is fantastic. Standing Ovation, Protect My Energy, Never Make Promises, Point and Kill, a phenomenal track. Fear No Man, How Did You Get Here, and Misunderstood to finish it off. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Angel said don't let ego be a disturbance. In the demon said motherfucker you earnest, like they strip you of everything you're deserving. Realize there is a prison and nasty, a condition that's fucked. Man, it's like they can't sleep till our spirit is crushed. How much fighting must we do? We've been fearless enough. All we've seen is broken homes here in poverty, corrupt government officials, lies and atrocities. How they talking almost threatening the economy, knocking down communities to re-up on properties. I'm directly affected, it does more than just bother me. Look beyond the surface, don't you see what you wanna see? My speech ain't involuntary, projecting attention straight from my lungs. I'm a black woman and I'm a proud one. We walk in blind faith, not knowing the outcome. But as long as we're unified, then we've already won. As I'm going through this top 10, every album I go by, it's just so crazy that I'm putting these against one another, because I think I could put any of these at the top of my list. And coming up next, of course, we have Backwash's I Lie Here Buried With My Rings and My Dresses, a crushing, crushing album this one is. Now, honestly, if this released last year, this definitely would have been my album of the year. I mean, any of these albums in the top 10 or even the top 15 really would be the album of the year if it released last year, but this year is just way too omega stacked that this album is in my top 8 most favorites. And this is of course an industrial hip hop album, and that industrial side to the album of course fuses with the genre metal, and of course there is some horrorcore thrown in there as well. It's a very heavy, aggressive, noisy, angry, and relentless album. The performance by Backwash here is passionate and powerful. It's just filled with raw, aggressive energy just coming straight for your throat. It is just amazing. I love it. And if you didn't know already, industrial and of course hip hop are two of my favorite genres. So fusing them together for industrial hip hop is just an easy win for me. I mean, Death Grips, one of my favorite bands of all time, one of the most genre bending and forward thinking and groundbreaking bands of all time, if not the most. And what Backwash displays here is something very worthy of that same level. It is a genre pushing, and at the same time, to its core, it's industrial hip hop, and it's just a hard as hell album. I do definitely recommend listening to this one. And of course, if you're not too into the industrial genre, this might be a little bit too much. But of course, if you are into metal, if you're into industrial, if you're into hip hop, you should definitely go into this album, because of course the concept of the album, or the concepts within the tracks, are very great as well. Well thought out, very introspective, and it's also very hateful at some points as well. Very political, and it gets you thinking, it gets you very invested in the feeling of this album. It's just perfectly done, and I can't say enough good things about this album. Like, a lot of this album appeared at the end of my Spotify top list, and it is no surprise why. I mean, I love production, and the production on this album is top tier. Very well done, well crafted, well put together, well thought out. Everything is just on a very great performance here, and I do love it quite a lot, especially the production. The production on this one is killer. But yeah, very dark, heavy, heavy album this one is. Definitely do give it a listen. My favorite tracks on this one is of course Wail of the Banshee, and of course the title track, a very crazy one there. And right after that we got Terror Packets, one of my absolute favorites, one of my songs of the year. And of course right after that we have another one of my absolute favorites, In Thy Holy Name. And of course one of the songs I played the most on this album, Songs of Sinners, very phenomenal track there as well. And of course we got Nine Hells and Burn to Ashes to finish off all my favorites. Relentless flows, dark concepts, and hard punching, crushing production. This one definitely is a standout album for me. But yeah, let's play a sample and I'll move on into the next album.
Myself to some help with the damage I suffered, and so with the baggage I held, cause that's a soul I'm screaming, fuck, Simon the horse, pick me up, devils and angels will fight for the rest of my soul, life is a wreck on the stump.
Man, just looking at the next few albums on this list here is making me kind of go slightly insane, because I'm like, why is it so low, but there's so much better stuff too, and it's like, where the hell do I put it? This is why if I made my best albums of the year list, I would probably go insane and have a stroke and die before I finish the video. Anyways, the very insane album I'm talking about here is of course it is The Alchemist and Armin Hammer coming up with a legendary duo album here, and one we definitely do want more of from this duo, and of course I'm talking about the amazing, the fantastic, the mind-bending conceptual masterpiece that is of course Haram. Now, where do I even start? Of course, we all know this duo. If you don't know the duo Arm & Hammer, of course, Billy Woods and Elucid. Definitely, I have to say, these guys have the best pen game of the decade, for sure. They write extremely dark, cryptic, poetic, and conceptual lyrics, and of course, their pen game is unmatched here. But the crazy thing is, Arm & Hammer is mostly known for the pen game already. The thing that stepped up in this album is of course the performances as well. There's lots of really great flows, very abstract types of energy is all over this album, and to top it all off, The Alchemist. Of course, The Alchemist, he of course made my list earlier, and he is back here again. Legendary producer, The Alchemist, on this album with, of course, already the unmatched pen game by Arm & Hammer. Alchemist is here bringing his what might be best production yet. Like last year, Alchemist on The Price of Tea in China with Boldy James, he brought this cold production that really matched this whole abstract vibe the album created with Boldy James, and the production was just on point on that album. Well, on point is an understatement for this album. Haram is extremely dark, very abstract and artistic. Alchemist brings these extremely menacing, dark, gritty, and dense beats to match the absolutely dense, bottomless pit that is the pen game of Arm & Hammer. There have been some collaborations between Arm & Hammer and Alchemist in the past, but it's never been a whole project of just Arm & Hammer writing their ass off and then Alchemist just bringing the most cohesive and absolutely mind-blowing production. This is definitely a staple album, one to look for and look back at in the future, because this is definitely one of the best hip-hop albums I've heard in a long time. And I think it'll only get better with age as everyone starts to unveil all the absolutely mind-blowing concepts and all of the crazy ideas put together in this album. Once people start to pick that apart and unveil the true nature of this album, because it is just so much packed into this album. You could write whole university papers about all of these tracks, because it's just so much content in each track, and it's all perfectly put together by Alchemist, creating this aura, this menacing aura all across the album. I just don't know what to say. It is just perfectly executed. Like, the first verse of the album lets you know that this is it. We are here and this is what this album is gonna be, so get your ass prepared for it. Now, of course, this is an abstract hip-hop album, if you couldn't tell already. It's also hardcore hip-hop, conscious hip-hop, very experimental as well, and it's very cryptic, very political, dark, and it's dense, creates this huge conscious atmosphere and this menacing introspective and philosophical points of view. It is a very difficult album to digest and take apart just because it is so cryptic, poetic, and just so much packed into one track after track. The concepts on some of the tracks dive into a lot of heavy topics, and it's filled with academic references that'll have you diving through many grad school studies and books and just a whole bunch of stuff you're gonna be researching. And the more you dive into this bottomless pit, the more you realize this album is intelligently crafted. It is just pure intelligence and genius at display. Lots of the core concepts revolve around the criminal justice system and, of course, systemic racism, inequality of society's progression, concepts diving into the capitalist society's impact on people, self-checking and inner cop mentality, and that mental control that comes with that mind state. That's just the surface of all the clever, intelligent concepts woven into these tracks. There's just so much academic references and intelligence just put into this album, laid out very cryptically, so it's very hard to go through. It's just truly mind-blowing. I could talk about this album for hours and hours and hours, so I'm just gonna list my favorite tracks already. Of course, Sir Benny Miles, amazing. Roaches Don't Fly, amazing. Black Sunlight, amazing. Indian Summer, amazing. Aubergine, one of my favorite songs of the year. God's Feet, fantastic. Pepper Tree, amazing. Scaffolds, amazing. Falling Out the Sky, phenomenal. Wishing Bad and Chicharrones, that duo track is mind-blowing. And of course, Robert Moses and Stone Fruit to finish off my most favorites. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Start circling my vicinity. If you give and give it willingly, this is cleansing fire coat did, purified by the OC. Fully charged, I'm a sun, I'm a star. I got range, I know just who I are. Weave what he want, and it's still on the one. Cause I wander don't mean that I'm lost. Cause I wonder don't mean that I'm stumped. Bending wheels to exactly what I want. I've been hunted, I've been shielded, I feel love here.
With the truthfulness which impressed you, with the idea almost that he himself just returned from the journey, existed.
I send brothers to the store, I keep son in the cupboard. I'm stubborn, I am my mother's love, measured in eyedroppers. Burn rubber from the coppers, the eye doctor left shock. My third eye don't believe me, just watch my chakras.
Okay. Crazy, crazy, crazy. And speaking of absolutely crazy, this next album is just, I don't even know what to say. I mean, look, Kick 3, Arca's Kick 3. To say this album is insane is an understatement. Now, how many times will Boogle mention Death Grips in this video? Because Kick 3, I think, is one of the most forward-thinking albums since the last Death Grips project. Kick 3 is an experimental hip-hop slash glitch hop slash industrial hip-hop album. Once again, Arca is displaying just straight-out artistry throughout this album, building these manic beats after manic beats, track after track. Once again, to say the production is insane is a huge understatement. Arca goes to the next level here, pushing forward and really experimenting and pushing the boundaries here. This might not only be a benchmark album for Arca as an artist, but also for music in general, because it is just such a forward-thinking album. Such a futuristic and chaotic album, so experimental and artistic. There's gonna be a lot learned from this and is gonna be a staple going forward. Now, before the sudden barrage of Kick albums from Arca here, I wasn't too up to date with Arca. I wasn't that much in the following. But of course, I knew that Arca did work with Kanye in the past on, of course, Yeezus, producing some tracks and stuff there. And then I kind of forgot about Arca, but boom, we just get the huge drop, dropping 5 or 4 albums in 1 month. And of course, I mentioned one earlier, Kick 5. And here we have Kick 3, the most insane, chaotic, futuristic, noisy, dense, rhythmic, complex, abstract, forward-thinking, mind-bending, and boundary-pushing albums Arca has dropped yet. Arca's production on here is not the only thing that is very great, because of course Arca's performance on this album as well is so passionate and very aggressive and just in your face. Some of the rapping on here did surprise me a bit. The flows were almost near flawless, though some of the lyrics are questionable at times and very abstract at some times as well. It becomes hard to understand, of course, but of course the center of this album, the heart of this album, lies in the production, but we just can't ignore the performance from Arca on here as well. The mind-bending instrumentation on this album is just really something to get lost into and just absorb with everything you got. It's just straight banger track after banger track, no rest, it's just relentless. It is definitely an album way ahead of its time, like most Death Grips albums are, even now, still, even a decade later. And I won't be surprised if that's the case with the Kick series, or Kick 3 at the very least. Just a vulgar, energetic, futuristic masterpiece here, and I highly recommend it. Of course, it is super experimental, so you might not quite enjoy it the first time if you are new to this experimental genre, or industrial, or experimental hip-hop. You might just puke when you listen to this album. But to those who are adventurous and that love experimental music, that love the boundary-pushing, futuristic, and artistic expression, this is definitely a must-listen album. One of the best albums of 2021. One of my most favorites, of course. My favorite tracks on here is every single track, yes, track 1 to 12, all amazing, great, masterfully crafted. The instrumentation is just mind-blowing. The performances on some of the tracks are passionate and energetic and in your face. It's just great. Highly recommend listening to this album. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album.
My face spinning, helicopter hopping over troubled waters, radially. Go to sleep, liminal. I'm gonna love what's mine. I'm gonna take my time. Residual energy amplifies. My love, raining, skyward, up through my body, my flesh lights up. Say your ripples make ripples. Say your ripples make ripples. Say your ripples make ripples. Say your ripple 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 make ripples. Say
your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. Say your ripple make ripples. It's more of a whole piece than an album separated into tracks, even though it is one piece and this piece has different movements as it progresses. It is all just meticulously perfectly put together. Of course, this is a post-minimalism album or a minimalism album. It's a progressive electronic album as well. Of course, there's that spiritual jazz, of course, in there. And it is ambient as well, very ambient. The meeting of the two minds here crafted something so beautiful and progressive and suspenseful and terrifying at some points. It's really just a huge, full movement of emotion. It's only 40 minutes long, this piece of music, and I have to say, this is one of the most beautiful pieces of music I've heard ever. The chilling and ethereal, soothing atmosphere this album creates, or this music piece creates as a whole, as it progresses, just gets you lost in this hypnotic, atmospheric world. It is very relaxing, it is very peaceful, but at some points, it gets very intense, and it is a lot to take in. There's lots of emotion put into this album. If you take the time to just sit down and thoroughly listen to this album, of course, it is an ambient project at the heart, so you can play it in the background. But if you really take the time to just listen to this album and just get lost into this expansive universe this album creates, it is really something special. It's minimal yet grand. The production is just top tier, all at 10. Of course, this album is a 10 for me. It is a 10 out of 10, one of the 10s for me in 2021. If I was making the best albums of the year list, this would be up a lot higher as well. Just the mysterious and sheer emotion put to this album and what this piece creates and just how it progresses and every little detail you hear as it progresses and changes into these different movements is so clever and hypnotizing. It's just very addicting. Like, one of the times I did sit and listen through this music piece, I almost shed a tear at one point. That's just how much beautiful emotion and ethereal production there is here. It is just overwhelming. Of course, it's one piece broken into different movements that progress, and every movement there is a core instrument that really you focus on as the movement progresses. Then it just transitions and it just, I don't even know how to explain it. It's just so perfectly done. This album is a must listen. No questions asked. It is a must listen album for 2021. One of the absolute best, most stunning albums I've ever heard. Not only just in 2021, but overall. It is expansive, dense, and progressive. So you do have to be patient at some points though. It is a music piece that's only 40 minutes long, so highly recommend going into it. And let the sound of this album just envelop you and just take you somewhere, because you can really go somewhere with this album. Use it to sleep. I've listened to this album sleeping many, many times throughout the year. Use it while you study, use it while you work. Just listen to it in full and let the emotion take over. Whatever you do, this album is a masterpiece. 10 out of 10. Really, really love this one. Of course, it is my top 5 most favorite, and I still listen to it very frequently. And yeah, it's just nothing else to say. Just a phenomenal, phenomenal piece of art. My favorite tracks, of course, this is one whole music piece separated into different movements, so of course, the whole music piece is my favorite track. But if we were to go into specific movements, of course, movement 6 and movement 9 is definitely my most favorites. Movement 6 just starts so stunningly beautiful and just gradually progresses and has this terrifying yet ethereal climax. It's just hauntingly beautiful, and I cannot get enough of it, and I cannot say enough good things about this album. Let's play the sample and we'll move on into the next album. Stunning. Done, but there is four more behemoth albums I gotta talk about, and my fourth most favorite album of 2021 is also one of my other 10 out of 10s. I think my only other 10 out of 10 this year. I mean, a lot of albums got extremely close, but this one is just immense. Just very immense. And of course, I am talking about none other than Lingua Ignota's Sinner Get Ready. And this is the, of course, the highly anticipated follow-up to Ignota's previous record in, of course, 2019, I'm pretty sure. And that album was absolutely insane. And this album is toned down a bit, but it is still very frightening, very terrifying, and absolutely insane as well. Now, I don't even know what to classify this album as. I guess you can say it's avant-folk. It's neoclassical for sure. Chamber is well in there. Of course, folk I've already mentioned. But it is just a lot. There's just way too much in this album, and it is just a behemoth, menacing force. The concepts on this album is very thought-provoking and very dense and dark at sometimes as well. Of course, the performance here is toned down from Caligula. Of course, the previous album Lingua Ignota dropped, it is toned down, but it's still so menacing and terrifying. And the production to back it up as well is just so grand and thought out, and it's just perfectly put together. Creates this menacing wall of sound that's just so serious and angry and terrifying. It's violent. It's very violent, and the concepts on here is very scary, and of course it's ominous. Of course, there's lots of concepts about God thrown in here as well, which is just something you can talk about forever, for hours and hours, just diving into all the concepts in this album, just picking apart the artistic choices and all the introspective concepts in this album. The eerie drone that's sometimes in the production as well just sets this very death-heavy tone and this very depressive tone as well. What this album feels like is facing God face-to-face, and that menacing aura and that very powerful, just crushing and utterly terrifying experience that would be. That is basically what this album is, and that's the best way I can describe it. Of course, with the very scary and terrifying sides of this album, of course there is a contrast, and there are some very beautiful, and of course the drone moments of the album where it's a lot more toned down and depressive. You can tell she really studied the folk music here, and it is a huge influence on this album. And it is very well done, and it creates this raw atmosphere as well that just goes with everything, and it is just all perfectly crafted. I mean, it's a 10. A 10 is perfect, and this album is what I would consider a perfect album. It's an unsettling nightmare, yet a beautiful, atmospheric, and dense wall of sound at some points. It's just a lot to take in, and there's also a lot to uncover for when you do come back to this album. I mean, it's just song of the year after song of the year on this album, just full tracks layered heavily and very atmospheric, and the stunning concepts, of course, diving into God and the beautiful ballads on here. It is just something really great and something really special to really listen to, and it is a must listen, of course. It's not industrial, but it is leaning towards that industrial side at some points, bringing that sheer wall of sound and just dark, dense production. A very, very powerful album. This one is a phenomenal one, a one to listen to, and one of the best, if not the best album of 2021. Very insane, very crazy, very beautiful. There's nothing more I can say about this album. Otherwise, we would be here for quite a long time, but my favorite tracks on here is, of course, the first track, the menacing start to the album. The Order of Spiritual Versions, of course, is the name of the first track. I Who Bend the Tall Grasses, the second track, very menacing as well. Many Hands, fantastic track. Pennsylvania Furnace, an amazing, beautiful piece of music. Repent Now, Confess Now, very raw, and I just love the sound of that track as well. The Sacred Liniment of Judgment, a very beautiful track and suspenseful track as well. Perpetual Flame of Centralia, also a very beautiful track and a very stunning one on here. Man is Like a Spring Flower, also a very amazing track, might be my favorite on this album, but it's close. I mean, there's just so many great tracks. It's a must listen. Go definitely listen to it. It's only like an hour long. Very stunning album. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. Top three favorite albums of 2021. My God. Well, in at number three, we have the fantastic, the amazing, the addicting JPEG Mafia, bringing what is, I think, his best album yet. Of course, LP. Now, of course, with JPEG Mafia, this is an experimental hip-hop album slash a hardcore hip-hop album, and of course the instrumentation, the production, everything is just very experimental and very aggressive as well. JPEG Mafia is one of the artists that carried the very futuristic, groundbreaking sound of Death Grips and took it forward and moved it along and popularized it and made it something very addicting as well. And with his latest album right here, which might be his most experimental album yet. I mean, it's really between Veteran and LP. All My Heroes Are Cornballs is the more melodic and, of course, conceptual album. While Veteran, it is conceptual as well. LP, it's a lot more focused on the production, and it is just amazing. This is definitely my most favorite JPEG album. Like I said before, I think it is his best album yet. And there is two versions of this album. Of course, the streamable version that's on all platforms. And of course, there was label issues and sample usage issues. So we got the offline version where the samples are there. Everything is there. Nothing's really cut out and stuff is expanded. And of course, it is the superior version. But either version here, we're gonna go with the offline version. LP is fantastic. Of course, the theme here with the last few albums on my list is they've been so boundary pushing, and JPEG Mafia's LP here is no shortcoming of a boundary pushing album for him, and it is very, very addicting, this one. Some of his most catchy and well-produced tracks are on this album, and some of the most hard-hitting and just bombastic and raw performance tracks is on here as well. The beautiful sample usage, and it is just so sad that the samples weren't all cleared on this album, but hey, at least we got the amazing offline version. JPEG Mafia's artistic expression really steps it up a level here, and you can really hear it in the performance and the whole sound of this album. Of course, once again, the production really being the centerpiece of this album, crafting just a very fun, very addicting, very punchy album. Out of all the albums in this whole list, I think this album, LP, the offline version specifically, has to be the album I absolutely enjoyed the most out of everything. The production is just so good and forward-thinking. It's like JPEG Mafia, he just never misses at this point. It is just hard to tell. Of course, there is no real main concept of this album. It does dive into certain topics that goes throughout what he's been going through these past few years and goes into some other topics throughout his life as well. But overall, the production just really hard carries this one, and it's not a bad thing at all. Not to take away from the amazing performances from JPEG Mafia on this album as well. The very raw flows, the hard energy, and the amazing confidence you hear in this album is just something really to witness. Of course, I was already expecting a very great project from JPEG Mafia with his EP series he's been doing. Of course, I talked about it a bit in my previous video, how I was very excited for what's next for JPEG Mafia. And this album he came up with here and dropped in 2021 completely blew all my expectations. And yes, it is the most enjoyable album in 2021 for me. Definitely one to listen to. Just straight fire, banger after banger, and just amazing beats and production. JPEG Mafia just does it all. Producing, writing, mixing, mastering, performing. Just everything crafted so perfectly here. And I cannot get enough of it. It's like the culmination of Veteran and All My Heroes Are Cornballs put together into this one massive behemoth album that JPEG created here. And of course, by that I mean production and performance wise. Like, a lot of my most played songs of the year definitely are off this album, without a doubt. I mean, Hazard Duty Pay is a song of the year, if not the song of the year. Just a phenomenal effort from JPEG Mafia here, and his best album yet, and the most enjoyable album for me in 2021. My favorite tracks on here is, of course, every single track. Yes, even the interlude type tracks, they are just so well done, and everything just moves into the other so fluently, and the whole flow of the album is just flawless. And yes, every single track is amazing. But of course, the one standout I would have to name here is Hazard Duty Pay, of course. But let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album.
You think you know me?
There's a fear of a nightfall. Darkness comes and covers all.
Your black feel like business to me. Industry lies never line up on screen. And you keep scoring, I feel like the dream.
Yeah, what you want?
This is so crazy because I never thought that this album would be overtaken by another album in 2021 for me in my list. But at number two, we have the one and only, the crazy, fantastic, mind-blowing Black Midi's Cavalcade. Now, this album is so damn good that I thought there would be nothing else that would come close to overtaking it as my most favorite album of the year. While the JPEG Mafia album was very surprising and very enjoyable, the most enjoyable, of course, I went back to Cavalcade and I'm like, it's not quite on that crazy level that Cavalcade is on. But of course, there is an album, and that album we'll get into later. But for now, Cavalcade, this is a chaotic and progressive and utterly manic masterpiece. It's an avant-garde slash prog rock slash math rock album, of course experimental rock as well. I guess you could say noise rock as well, with all the chaotic production at some points. But of course, it is also a jazz rock album, and what I like to call this album is chaotic jazz prog rock. And of course, it is very complex, it is very suspenseful, it is extremely progressive and satisfying, it's cryptic and poetic, it's passionate and melodic. It is just so much packed into one album. What is this, like 40 minutes? And it's of course the second studio album from this UK rock band, and it is definitely the highly anticipated one. But this also highly anticipates the third album from Black Midi, because this one was just such an insane leap and such a forward-thinking yet boundary-breaking one. It is just crazy to think about what the third album is going to be. You have moments on the album where the instrumentation is so grand, chaotic, aggressive, and dense. Then you get the contrast, the beautifully perfect contrast, where some of the instrumentals are toned down and slowed a bit, and the melodies are really put in the core, and it's just ethereal and surreal. It is just very perfectly done. It is quite fascinating. Track 1 to track 8 is just this amazing roller coaster. The flow of the album is flawless. The transitions into each track is perfectly done, and the instrumentation throughout each track as it progresses is so perfectly done as well. It just very satisfyingly drags you in and puts you in this aura of sound and beauty. Like John L. and Hogwash and Balderdash is some of the most chaotic things I've heard throughout the whole year. Yet there's tracks like Marlene Dietrich and Diamond Stuff is some of the most beautiful things I've heard the entire year. You would think these ideas would clash together, but it's just so well done that it's just all flowing together perfectly and flawlessly. It just blows my mind how it is even this perfect. And I think you would have what I call the best track run of the year on this album, with Chondra Malaysia Patella, Slow, Diamond Stuff. All those three tracks back to back are like songs of the year contenders, just back to back on this album. It is just all mind blowing. It is just relentless and you cannot get enough of it. It is a must listen album. It is too good to be true. I don't know how they have done it, but they have done it. Black Midi here crafted one of the best albums of the year and one of my absolute most favorite albums of the year. It would have been the most favorite album of the year, but of course there is another album that quite surprised me. My favorite tracks on here is of course every single track, all phenomenal, great tracks, just great track after great track, and finishing off with Ascending Forth, which might be the best closing track of 2021, period. I just can't say enough good things about this album. Go definitely listen to this album. It is a must-listen album for 2021. Mind-blowing. Just absolutely mind-blowing. Let's play a sample and we'll move on into the next album. And yes, Slow is my song of the year, for sure. Closely followed by Chondra Malaysia Patella and Diamond Stuff, which is just insane to think about. But yeah, let's play this sample. We are here. The one album. First album. First favorite album. I am going insane. And speaking of insanity, pure, utter insanity, we have here my most favorite album of 2021. A crushing one. And it is none other than Injury Reserves by the Time I Get to Phoenix. Now, where the hell do I even start with this album? This is the album that overtook what I thought would be my most favorite album of the year confidently. And it just came out of nowhere at the end of the year. I was expecting an Injury Reserve drop, but not something this crazy. Of course, this is the album after the passing of Groggs, and it carries a very heavy weight. And what can I say? What can I say? It is the pinnacle of experimental hip-hop music here for 2021, and it is the boundary-pushing, genre-bending, and genre-pushing magnum opus for Injury Reserve. Like, what can you even classify this album as? Yes, it is experimental hip-hop at the core, but it's so much more than that. It's so abstract. There's like experimental rock thrown in there. There's so much glitch thrown in there. Some psychedelia thrown in there. There's some industrial hip hop in there. Some glitch hop in there. I think the genre this album would identify as is post-rap or post-hip hop or post-experimental hip hop. This album created a new genre. That is how crazy it is. It is Injury Reserve's mind-bending magnum opus requiem. And we say requiem because, of course, Groggs. Groggs' presence on this album is very difficult to listen to. And it is... I can't even imagine how hard it was to put out this album. It's just very crushing, and there is a lot of very dark, poetic, and pessimistic and cryptic concepts throughout this whole album. It is so complex, existential, and futuristic. It is just way too much to handle on one listen. The way I would describe this album is like a huge nuke going off, and the aftermath of the nuke is what this album sounds like. That album cover, that red, dark, and dense album cover mixed with these abstract, glitchy, and eerie, and expansive sounds. It is just so mind-bending and extremely crushing and depressing. It is just way too much. And that is why I absolutely love it. It is not something to listen to casually. It is very complex and very difficult to digest. It is one you'll have to take multiple listens to understand the lyrical concepts throughout this whole album. Even some parts performed by Groggs in here, it is just so crushing to listen to because what he dives into lyrically is just so sad and depressing. It's like, what can you even say? Mixed with the crazy sample usage throughout the whole album, like phenomenal samples and the amazing top tier production on here. Of course, taking huge influence from Death Grips and JPEG Mafia on this album. Even to at some points hearing some samples of Death Grips in there. There's just millions of influences, references, samples thrown together in this masterpiece of an album. With it being the most experimental album Injury Reserve has come out with, and the most dark one as well, very difficult to listen to as a very hardcore fan as Injury Reserve. I would imagine that it was very difficult to go through this album because it is just very serious, very cryptic, and it is disturbing to some points. Now, there's one track on here that I still don't quite understand. Of course, it is Wild Wild West, and even though the instrumentation and production is great on that track, I don't think it really fits on this album. But other than that, without that track, this album is a 10 out of 10 easy, very easily, and it is just overwhelming. Just the extremely depressing concepts diving into this album. It is really one to experience and just let take over with the production. It is an album that speaks for itself, and it of course has some of the best tracks of the year on here with some of the most amazing performances ever by Injury Reserve yet, with the most insane production yet, of course. It's everything you could have wanted from an injury reserve album just put into this one crushing magnum opus requiem. It's like that nuke going off in this album is that aftermath of the nuke, that apocalyptic state of just trying to survive and trying to find some meaning in the environment around you, trying to grasp onto a reality, trying to pick up this world that's falling apart in your hand. It is just so very crushing. It is easily one of the best albums of the year, and of course it is my absolute favorite album of the year, being such a behemoth of an album. You just cannot ignore this one. Highly recommend listening to it, and of course it is very experimental, so keep that in mind when going into it. My favorite tracks on here is everything. Every single track is my favorite. Even though Wild Wild West is out there on this album, doesn't really fit too much, it is still on my favorites because the production is just crazy and I love it a lot. But the standouts on here, of course, Outside, Superman, that's one of my songs of the year. And of course, I gotta mention Top Picks For You, just absolutely crushing, depressing song. That one is very haunting, very just overwhelming, that song is. And of course, Knees, another one that is just absolutely crushing. And of course, one of my songs of the year. This album is just grand. It is grand, yet so chaotic and depressive and just pure insanity. There's nothing more I can really describe about this album, because what can you even say? There isn't words to describe what this album is. That's what this era, this album creates is, and it is something real special, something to be looked back upon, and something I'm definitely going to be listening to moving forward. Phenomenal, phenomenal, phenomenal album, and just absolutely batshit crazy insane. Let's play a sample or two and we'll wrap up the video.
Take that, take that, take that, take that, take that. take my payment, baby, just take that. She said, we don't accept the swipey kind. I think these niggas might be lying. She, we ain't up to speed on that. Nah, we ain't got the green light of that. Oh, my signature don't match on that. I did that when snapbacks came back.
Lost in the tent. There's things I ain't rolling with. Things I ain't knowing yet. Things I ain't growing in.
Oh, don't worry, you gon' grow into those babies.
Who don't want mine, but ain't give me if I ain't knowing.
Just try them out. Put them on.
I ain't all this time. I don't think I'm growing anymore.
I don't think I'm growing no more. I don't think it's snowing no more. I'm feeling in my bones no more. I ain't too cool for oh no more. I ain't up to speed like that. I've been out the loop, so hold up, said I'll be right back. This record's in the trash for sure.
And that is it. That is my list for my top favorite albums of 2021. Let me guys know what albums you enjoyed the most in 2021 and what you think about this list and this album. Of course, I do have a Discord. Make sure you do join up. We could talk about music there. We definitely do need some more music people there, so definitely do join up. And what else can I say here? I guess, I mean, I made a Spotify playlist for 2021. And of course, I make one for pretty much every year. And if you want to check that out and see exactly what I did listen to and enjoy throughout 2021, of course, you can just check out that Spotify playlist. And I'll have that in the description somewhere. But yeah, a very behemoth video for a well-deserved behemoth 2021. Very stacked year for music, and I'm excited for 2022 and those drops. But yeah, it's been John Boogle, and see ya. And yes, I did do the Origins Easter egg completely.
Hey, son, that's too strong. Hey, blood is too strong. You can keep what you said, just tell it be, now you read what you sow. You can choose your own, do not love, but I says how that shit go. I can feel it in my bones, that I sure what they own. Hey, son, that's too strong. Every blood is too strong.